Hey, this is the 80 Slasher Librarian, just letting you guys know if you enjoy the content here on the channel and want to support the channel, click on the Patreon link in the description below. As I'm not allowed to monetize the channel here on YouTube, I depend on you guys to keep this channel going and growing by becoming patrons of the channel and sponsoring at the Patreon page.
There's a lover in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. You want it darker? We kill the flame. They're lining up the prisoners and the guards are taking aim. I struggled with some demons, they were middle class and tame. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker?
Happy Friday the 13th, Slashaholics. Today, I'm going to give you a little sneak peek at the next Jason book that will be narrated here on the channel. It's still a couple books away, but in celebration of Friday the 13th, I'm going to share with you the first chapter of Friday the 13th, Part 3D, by Michael Avallone. There were two versions of the Part 3 novelization written, one by Michael Avallone and one by Simon Hawke. There's quite a few differences between the two books and the movie. So I'm going to cover both of these books on the channel. And since this is the strangest one by far from what I've heard, I'm going to start with it. So without further ado, whether you're listening on Friday the 13th or you're listening later on after I've started narrating this book fully, get ready for Friday the 13th Part 3D by Michael Avallone. There is a sign that is always posted on houses that harbor hatred and horror. Tourist accommodated. Philip St. George, the Satan sleuth. Chapter 1. Death comes at the beginning. There was something ominous about the radio newscaster's voice that morning. The familiar crackling tenor had taken on a tone of utter solemnity. No one within earshot or listening range of Ed Harris's habitually breezy voice had ever heard him so muted and so impressed with the import of his own words. "And I'm Ed Harris with the KLTZ Early Morning Report. Crystal Lake in Pinehurst County, the scene of several unsolved deaths years ago, is tragically back in the top of the news this morning. Police have uncovered the remains of 8 as-yet unidentified persons in a gruesome and baffling story of mass murder." If you were familiar with Harris's vocal style, you could catch the beat he took before he went on. "Judging from the sheer brutality of the murders, police theorize that they must have been committed by at least 4 people." There was but one pregnant pause, a heartbeat's worth of time. "The sole survivor of the massacre has been taken under heavy sedation to County Hospital in Linfield for observation. She's been unable to provide police with any clues and is being kept under round-the-clock guard." Ed Harris had never made such a dire broadcast in all his years as a career newscaster, and had probably thought he never would. Not many radio announcers ever had when you got right down to it. Jack the Ripper had closed down his shop almost 100 years ago, but now in this day and age, everything was possible. This was 1982, corpses away. No matter how awesome, how horrible, the Crystal Lake killer was far from done, miles from being finished. Or was it killers, plural? No one knew for sure, or could have said with any certainty. Certainly not Ed Harris of Station KLTZ. Toward evening of that fatal day, the dying sun shot its final rays over a setting that could have been lifted from a Norman Rockwell painting. A time-worn country marketplace, flanked by a long line of bushes just turning their leaves to the colors of autumn, stood remote and isolated in the Pinehurst County wilderness. A wide gravel parking area fronted the place, leading out to the state highway which ran past its bucolic facade. Harold and Edna's was a kind of ma-and-pa kettle structure, almost a vision of times gone by. The high bushes and engulfing grass were overgrown, unattended, strengthening the aspect of dismal neglect. The building had a battered second story, the living quarters of those who presided over this ancient country kingdom. The wooden frame was unpainted, scabbing with age. Shutters on the windows showed missing slats. The rotting rooftop indicated an immediate need for repair. The waning sunlight etched all these failings in streaks of golden illumination. A heavy truck roared by on the highway, its motor's thunder shattering the stillness. The silence that followed was heavy and thick, only to be broken again by the sound of a radio playing somewhere. A news broadcast, incredibly out of time and place, in this rural graveyard of a place. Judging from the sheer brutality of the murders, the police theorize, it was nothing more than a repeat of Ed Harris's awesome morning report on the Crystal Lake murders, a rerun of the horrors. Beyond the crumbling house and the storefront, a sagging clothesline swayed in the evening dusk in a very narrow backyard, running its length through a rickety wooden shed. The clothesline was supported by a solitary pole. Linen and sundry garments hung on the line, billowing in a strong breeze. Among them, a pair of flapping khaki pants and an olive-green shirt hanging side by side. The radio voice talked on, louder now, as if the volume had been turned up. The sole survivor of the massacre has been taken under heavy sedation to County Hospital in Linfield for observation. She's been unable to provide police with any clues. Suddenly, the shrouds of wet laundry parted, and a man emerged, making his slow way back toward the house. The transistor radio, jutting from one pocket of his threadbare shirt, pinpointed the radio voice. Kept under round-the-clock guard. The man grunted with inflection and worked a thumb along his nose almost abstractedly. He was paunchy, unshaven, lost somewhere in his 40s, a man from whom time had passed by without even his noticing. Clumsily, he collided with the solitary clothesline pole on his return to the house. A pole he should have known was there, for he had passed it 1,000 times. The transistor continued to blare its dreadful news, filling the backyard with modern times and all its awesome potentialities. An upstairs window overlooking the backyard abruptly grated upward, and a worn-faced, dried-out woman thrust her angry countenance into view. Her sullen mouth, unlipsticked and sour, spewed down venom. "God damn it, Harold! I spent all day yesterday washing your clothes, and look what you're doing to 'em! Shows how much you care about me and what I wash around here!" Harold slumped awkwardly on the earth, surrounded by the clean laundry he had brought down in his collision with the pole. Stared yearningly upward, but only for a moment. The dream that Edna and he had shared had been killed by her a long, long time ago. He staggered erect, pulling the garments with him. The volume of the little transistor picked up as he did so. Ed Harris's voice continued, drowning out Edna's harangue and the possibility of a tirade. "Easy, woman," Harold muttered under his breath. "No problem." Edna, face working, recognizing defeat again, disappeared from view as she slammed the window shut vehemently. Police today are working on a variety of leads. Harold, sighing, clicked the transistor radio off. The silence closed in again. The sun continued its downward plunge beyond the far horizon. In the upstairs living room, Edna stomped away from the window in a cold fury. The years had only strengthened, not diminished, her war with her husband. Lips compressed, she turned her attention to the partially functional old clunker of a black-and-white TV set, which Harold had provided for her use. It was better than nothing in this godforsaken wilderness. She flipped the set on and plopped herself down in disgust on the lumpy, faded couch that faced the thing, scooping up her knitting needles. Flicking the pair of them expertly, she resumed her work on a sweater. She ignored her surroundings of mustiness and clutter. The living room was more like an old attic, and she had given up on that too long ago, just as she had on Harold. But suddenly there was something new in her life. An earnest-faced TV reporter was staring back at her, saying the darndest things. Edna forgot her knitting for a long moment. A police spokesman tells Eyewitness News that authorities have been combing the area since just before dawn. Reports of cannibalism and mutilation are still unconfirmed. Nevertheless, these murders are already being called the most brutal in local history. The mutilations, because of their sexual characteristics, according to medical experts, indicate a psychotic personality. Edna, intent now, leaned forward to adjust the long rabbit ear antenna, spreading the rods apart to get a better picture. But the audio was perfect and all too clear and plain. The motive behind the grisly murders remains a mystery at this hour, as does the identity of the killer or killers. The search continues for more bodies. "My God," Edna murmured to herself. "My God, my God." Residents of the Lake Region are being urged to take extra precautions whenever approaching strangers and to report anything unusual to police immediately. We'll be back with the weather forecast after this important message. Upset now, Edna rose from the couch, the sweater forgotten, and tried not to run to the door leading to the downstairs market. She was a woman who had been pretty once and finally figured, but dead dreams and a bad marriage had overwhelmed all of that. She had not had too much education, but she did have imagination. That refuge of the whole of man and womankind, and she knew what the words cannibalism and mutilation meant. Sexual mutilation, my God. She pulled back the door and shouted down the stairwell, "Harold, what are you doing down there?" There was no answer, no response of any kind, not a sound. She rushed to the window, jerking it upward once more. "Harold, I want to talk to you." The backyard was empty. The laundry quietly swayed in the evening wind. It was getting darker now, all too fast. Edna clutched at her bosom, straining to see down into the yard, past the clothesline. For an instant, she thought she saw a human form visible between the two layers of drying clothes. From her vantage point, it was difficult to make out quite clearly who it was. Yet who else could it be in her own backyard but her husband? Nobody else belonged there. "Harold?" Edna called out fearfully. Again, there was no reply. The indistinct outline vanished from her gaze. A trick of the evening shadows, the half-light. Now the TV blasting behind her unnerved her once more. She went back to the set and turned it off. Then she returned to the window, peering out unhappily. "Harold, damn you, where are you?" There was no sign of anyone or anything. Edna was too upset and nervous to notice that there was now a gap in the overfilled clothesline where several articles of clothing had hung only seconds ago with all the rest of the wet laundry. The khaki pants and olive green work shirt were now gone. Edna stomped out of the room, determined to find the missing Harold before her nerves and her imagination got the best of her altogether. Damn, living out in the damn country. She literally flew down the rickety, uncarpeted steps to the store proper below. Her heart was pounding too fast, and her head was filled with all sorts of wild ideas and notions. "Harold! Harold!" The market was dark, save for random shafts of dying sunlight streaming through the grimy front windows. Edna scanned the gloomy aisles frantically. Still no sign of Harold. Her heart thumped fearfully in her bosom. My God, where was the man? She saw stacks of merchandise, canned goods, and bins filled with produce, but no Harold. Edna stepped timorously through the aisles. Harold? She called softly. There was almost affection in her voice now, not anger. She longed for the sight of him. A huge rabbit, gray and awesome for once, appeared as if by magic from behind a piled arrangement of Campbell's tomato soup cans, standing on its hind legs, whiskers bristling, eyes trying to guess Edna's next move. His sudden materialization made Edna jump, her eyes popped in alarm. But then she rallied and seized a tomato from the produce display on her right and hurled it angrily at the animal. "Goddamn pest, what are you staring at?" She had missed her target, and the rabbit had not even dodged. His eyes shone weirdly in the gloom. His whiskers made him look evil. In a frenzy, Edna pawed at the produce display, finding more vegetables and flung them wildly at her silent tormentor. This time, the rabbit dodged them all and scurried away with a burst of speed, disappearing down the long aisle. Edna, almost out of breath, tried to control herself. It wasn't easy. Things were happening too damn fast. The sunlight was almost gone. Gloom closed over the interior of the market, the dark shadows stretching and lengthening. Edna, clad only in a faded nightgown, pushed toward the screen door that led into the backyard. If she didn't discover where Harold was real soon, she tried not to think about that. The damn fool had to be somewhere, didn't he? She clawed her way through the sagging clothesline, touching a pair of pajamas, finding them still wet. They were clammy to her touch. She reached the uncommon gap in the line. She paused for a second. Clothes were missing, but which ones? But the shock was easily explained. Harold had taken them, of course, the pants and the work shirt. "Christ almighty, Harold," she blurted aloud to firm up her faltering courage. "You just take what's yours and leave the rest to me, is that it? I gotta bring all the rest of these clothes upstairs, huh? Very considerate." Sighing, she reached down for the wicker laundry basket close by on the hard earth and began to take the clothes from the line. "You could at least have finished the job. Do I have to do everything around here, Harold?" She heard a noise behind her. Frozen with fear, she whirled in terror, her hands going up to her breast. A sheet on the line, filling out awesomely, strangely, taking on the size and shape of a human form, billowed before her. She gulped. Her heart hammered violently, painfully. "Harold?" she murmured, swallowing hard. "I swear, you're such a child." Half defiantly, half hoping against all hope, she plucked at the sheet and ripped it off the line. It drooped like a flag to the earth. There was no one behind it. No Harold, no body. Edna almost passed out, overcome with her fears, which had produced nothing but more mental torment and more questions. Where was Harold? She stared up at the dark evening sky and pulled herself together. This was silly, altogether too ridiculous. That damn TV news show. Grimly, breathing deeply, she began to gather the remaining laundry off the line. Tossing the garments into the basket, she ignored the sinister rustlings and rattlings of the tree branches behind her. When she was done, she hauled the basket up, anchored it on her hip, and strode back to the house. She had to pass the ancient wooden shed on her route. It squatted like a dark sentinel in the light. The shed door creaked open with a snapping sound like a pistol shot. A crashing noise followed, a muffled clatter of things falling from within the walls of the wooden shed. Edna, with a low scream, rushed back into the store, slamming the door behind her. In her mind, all kinds of terrors surged to the surface. When it was safely shut, she put her back to it and closed her eyes. She thought her heart would burst, it was beating so fast. The night seemed to have 1,000 eyes, and they were all staring at her from the darkness engulfing her. Deeper in the store proper, Harold was blissfully, serenely, happy, and completely unaware of Edna's half hour of terror. The large white-gray rabbit, which had given Edna such a bad time, had hopped across a row of canned goods, spanning the journey with a leap to a nearby shelf. Harold had found him there, taken him gently by the nape of his furry neck, and deposited him up on his own shoulder. Harold and the rabbit were great friends, like master and dog. Harold then unscrewed the lid of a vacuum-sealed jar of peanuts, popped a handful into his own mouth, and fed the large rabbit the same. The animal munched contentedly on his shoulder. Harold returned the jar to the shelf after carefully re-screwing the lid on again, and flicked his pocket transistor radio back on. Music filtered through the silence of the store, a disco number. Harold hummed under his breath, tunelessly, Almost without thinking, he reached for a long-handled broom that was propped against the tier of shelves and began to sweep the floor of the market. The rabbit did not stir from his shoulder, busily finishing off his share of the peanuts. He did not lose his perch. Harold swept by the dairy case, paused in his occupation, and picked up a half-gallon jug of milk. He broke the seal and pulled off the cap. First he offered the rabbit a taste. That was refused. Then he gulped down a long, heartfelt swig for himself. Harold was a very simple man, which was one of the reasons his marriage was such a failure from the very beginning. He was not exactly a go-getter or an ambitious man. The libation refreshment done, Harold recapped the milk jug and returned it to the case, resuming his sweeping chore until he noticed the cellophane packages of carrots on display in the produce section moving ever so slightly. He rummaged beneath the pile and produced another rabbit, a white one this time, all white. The animal was diligently nibbling on a carrot. Harold smiled and parked the culprit on his free shoulder. Harold smiled again fondly at both his rabbit friends. "Sorry, guys. It's back to the slammer for you both, before Edna makes a fur coat out of each of you. Okay?" Still humming, the radio still playing, Harold trooped back to the rear door of the store. En route, he passed a rack of cakes and pies. He stopped long enough to open a box of 6 chocolate-covered donuts. He removed one, shoved it in his mouth, closed the package, and put it back on the rack, making sure to hide it behind several unopened packages. That was how Edna found him, with a rabbit on each shoulder and his cheeks filled with donuts. She was so glad to see him, so relieved, and so unable to explain her earlier fears that she immediately launched into her usual all-too-familiar role of nag, virago, and unhappy housewife. Or as Harold saw it, aggravated Edna. "Didn't I feed you enough today?" The rabbit shot from his shoulder at the sound of her furious voice, disappearing with a clatter beside the aisles of stacked goods. Edna planted herself before Harold, hands on hips, eyes shooting sparks. Harold could not answer. He was caught, and his mouth was full. "Didn't the doctor say you had to lose weight? I try to help you, but you sneak food behind my back. What am I gonna do with you? You're like a goddamn little kid, Harold." Harold blinked, face reddening. Edna did not, could not let up. "And put those filthy animals back where they belong, please." Harold nodded dumbly, turning away from her, going to retrieve his furry friends from their hiding places. They too feared Edna as he did, as he always had since the day his love for her had stopped. Dutifully, Harold did as she had ordered him. She stalked upstairs disgustedly, her terrors all set aside, temporarily at least. Anger and relief had washed away fear. Outside, the night winds had begun to set up an eerie serenade, whistling and whispering through the branches and leaves of the surrounding trees. It was always like that out there in the wilderness, especially after sunset, when darkness closed in from all sides. Edna had never liked that, not ever. With the gray and white rabbits back on his shoulders, Harold, still chewing the remainder of his donut, ambled across the darkened backyard. He had obtained a flashlight from the store to accomplish what Edna had ordered him to do. The wind rustled creepily in the night. Harold paid it no mind. Unlike Edna, he had no imagination whatsoever. The interior of the wooden shed which contained the hutch for the offending rabbits was as dark as a tomb. Harold thumbed the flashlight on as he entered. The stabbing glare illuminated old barrels, a wide variety of tools and sundry odds and ends collected down through the years. But the rabbits on Harold's shoulders squirmed uneasily and jumped off, scurrying away from him, squealing as they went, as if something was radically wrong about the shed this time. Harold frowned. "What are you little guys so nervous about? Edna set you off your feed." Chuckling, he fanned the flashlight's beam about the corners, trying to find his furry cronies. And then the flash stopped as Harold, his skin beginning to crawl, saw with his own eyes what had made White and Gray behave so funny. Mother of God! Through the grillwork of the hutch, the chicken wire had erected to keep them in. He saw the huddled, sprawled mass of furry forms. the contorted, bloody, glassy-eyed bodies of many dead rabbits. His tongue stuck to the roof of his mouth. The glinting, glassy stairs, the splattered crimson staining the bed of grass, newspapers, and old leaves was a shock he had never experienced in his lifetime. The limp carcasses of his pets, his beloved pets. His face twisted, hardened into a mask of outrage. The blood left his face. The carnage was so complete, so awful. "Who could do this?" Harold demanded thickly of the darkness. There was no answer, of course. There could not be. Trembling, he reached down for the lid of the hutch and lifted it. A big timber rattlesnake, three times as deadly and menacing because of its nearness, shot upward from the hutch, mouth distended and gleaming. The twin poisonous fangs arcing in the glare of the flashlight, riveted Harold where he stood. But his reflexes and pure instinct saved him. The rattler's hiss, uncoiling body, and deadly fangs vanished as Harold slammed the lid of the hutch down violently, losing his flashlight in the process. The shed was plunged into total blackness, and Harold lost his wits completely. Literally scared to death, he bolted from the shed, forgetting all about white and gray. His brain was a riot of terror and confusion. As he raced to safety, his hands ground into the pit of his own stomach to keep him regurgitating. His blood was churning, and the taste of bile in his mouth was like the kiss of death, cold and sickening. Behind him, the loathsome rattler hissed and spat with fury, and the rabbits, still left alive, whimpered in an agony of terror and despair. The big timber rattlesnake thrashed against its prison walls, the long, muscular body snapping like a bullwhip. The dead rabbits paid no heed. Harold burst through the door of the upstairs living quarters like a man gone mad. His eyeballs were two pools of horror. Edna, unsuspecting, was in his way when he thundered in. He bowled her over, knocking her to one side like a whirlwind. She tried to catch him, to hold on to him, not comprehending. Her own earlier terrors did not need this demented behavior on her husband's part. Not now, not tonight. "What happened, Harold? What's the matter?" He could not speak. His face was ashen, and still his hands were framed into his stomach. He shook his head at her and headed on into the bathroom. Edna stared after him in wonder. "It's all that crap you've been eating, I told you," she declaimed in righteous anger. "Stuffing yourself like you were a pig." She turned to the TV set again, turning up the volume to drown out the disgusting noises he was making in the bathroom. Flopping down on the lumpy couch, she reached for her knitting needles. One of them was missing. "Now where could that other needle have gone?" she mused. Edna couldn't find it, no matter how much she rummaged, and it was going to cost her. In the bathroom, a combination storage place in John, there were two ample cupboards facing each other, each leaning against a wall. A mess of boxes and crates lying on top of each other stood behind a dusty curtain. The toilet bowl, a remainder from the days when this was just an oversized bathroom, held the center of attention. The bowl was against the fourth wall at an angle behind the door. Harold, trousers down, stomach churning, made good use of it. The first bout of diarrhea had hit him hard. The sight of the gruesomely butchered rabbits and that king-sized snake hadn't helped either. He loosened his collar, sweat gleaming from his pudgy face. He pawed behind the toilet tank and produced his hidden bottle of whiskey, something Edna would never approve of, not in a billion years. Unscrewing the cap quietly, he took a hearty swig. He leaned back and shut his eyes, trying to sort out his thoughts and his feelings. What the hell was going on here? Those poor little creatures. Damn! Another swig made him feel a little better, but not much. Some of the liquor spilled, trickling down his unshaven chin. He wiped at it with one sleeved arm. His eyes roved aimlessly over the interior of the storeroom bathroom. The dusty curtain masking the boxes and crates seemed to ripple subtly, as if moved by an ever so slight draft of air, as if someone standing behind that curtain had let out a breath. Harold blinked. He shook his head again. Then came a small, hollow, brittle noise. From behind the curtain? Harold felt a chill. He tried to locate the noise, but couldn't figure out its source. It was over almost as soon as it had begun. Forgetting his position on the bowl, he shuffled over to one of the closets and yanked the door open. He saw nothing but empty shelves and layers of dust. Breathing in relief, Harold hitched up his pants again, just enough to enable him to hobble grotesquely toward the dusty curtain. It still fluttered all too suspiciously, random draft or not. Harold ripped it apart, seeing the odd assortment of boxes and crates. Empty, lifeless, and somehow uncannily menacing because of that very lifelessness. Harold shuddered, forgetting his uneasy stomach. He checked the other closet as well, with a glance first, and then he almost changed his mind. Reassured, he stumbled to it. His pants lowered past his hips. The closet had the look of a closet that had not been opened or entered in a long, long time. Harold tugged at the old door. It creaked and pulled back, opening. The huge oncoming hand holding a mammoth meat cleaver came at him from out of the darkness of the closet like an express train. Harold managed a half-scream, a bleat of horror and astonishment, as the cleaver came down, embedding itself in his chest like the hammer of God, or the devil, or maybe both. His scream mingled incongruously with the laughter issuing from the TV set that Edna was watching in the living room behind him. The hand twisted the cleaver in a vicious, merciless circle. Harold's chest exploded in flame and agony and death. His paunchy body toppled backwards, crashing to the floor. The meat cleaver jutted from his chest like a tombstone. Edna heard the crash from the other room where she sat. She turned off the television set with a frown and a habitual sigh. Clumsy Harold again. The man was all thumbs all the damn time. Harold! Harold! When no answer came, she left her seat on the couch and went to the bathroom door. It would not budge when she pushed against it. At her feet, she saw fluid seeping out from underneath the door. She stopped, dipped her fingers in the stuff, and sniffed. The toilet was now flushing inside, and it didn't stop the way it should have, as if someone had left their hand on the lever.
Harold, what is taking you so long in there? You all right?
Her nose had already provided her with some kind of answer, even if Harold hadn't. He had been hitting the bottle again.
Whiskey, I thought so,
she spouted grimly. She walked back to the desk in the living room, found the skeleton key she had placed there for emergencies such as this, and hurried back to the door. But before she could answer it, to her shock, she now found the bathroom door opened a crack. A tiny crack, but it was open. For a moment, she was nonplussed.
Harold?
Gingerly, she edged the door inward. It swung wide, revealing the boxes, the crates, the dusty curtain. The flushing noise was continuing unabated, a roaring Niagara. Almost reflexively, she stopped to pick up the half-empty whiskey bottle. Then she turned toward the maddening sound of that toilet to confront Harold with the damaging evidence of the bottle. She screamed at the sight of Harold sitting on the toilet, just behind the angled door. A Harold she had never seen before. Harold with his pants down, like a grotesque dummy of some kind. Something red drooling out of the corners of his mouth, two twin streams of crimson. The meat cleaver thrust outward from his chest. One of Harold's elbows was jammed against the flushing handle of the toilet tank. Harold's dead, sightless eyes were like two bits of broken glass. The whiskey bottle fell from Edna's senseless fingers. It hit the floor and shattered, scattering shiny shards. Edna began to scream uncontrollably. From somewhere behind her, the huge hand rematerialized. It did not hold a meat cleaver this time, though. It held the long, missing knitting needle. The hand drove the needle directly into the back of Edna's skull with such force and strength that the striking end pushed out through her screaming mouth, all in one lightning-like movement. Edna was gagging on her own blood as she died on the floor, without ever knowing why. Death walked in Pinehurst County again, for the 9th and 10th time in a matter of days. 2 days, to be exact. We'll be right back. Okay, Slashaholics, whether you're listening on Friday the 13th of December 2019 or any other time after that, this has been Chapter 1 of Friday the 13th, Part 3D, by Michael Avallone. This is an alternate version to the novelization, because there's also a novelization that's quite different for Part 3, written by Simon Hawke. I'll also be doing that one on the channel. But if you are listening to this on Friday the 13th of December 2019, this was just a sneak peek, because this is going to be the next Jason book I do on the channel when I get back to the Friday the 13th franchise on the audiobook rotation. Right now, I'm getting close to the middle of a Final Destination book, and then I've got a short little Freddy book to do and a Halloween one to do, and then I'll be completing this book after those two are done. So this is just a little sneak peek in celebration of Friday the 13th. Hope you guys enjoyed it. I thought the writing was pretty good. A couple choices he used for words didn't make much sense, and sometimes he used the same word really close together and it made it sound kind of weird. But other than that, it wasn't a bad chapter. It was well executed, it was written well, and I thought the whole excitement, paranoia angle with the shitty naggy wife, getting all upset and scared and then calming down. You think everything's mellow, and then the way he made the Herald guy find the dead rabbits and the snake, that brought it back up. And, of course, the death scenes in the bathroom. And the knitting needle was brutal. But, guys, let me know what you guys thought of the first chapter of this, and if you're looking forward to the rest of it. As always, this upload was brought to you by our patrons on the Patreon page, Carl Eakins, Catherine McClear, Sean Campbell, Cecilia Spears, and Hawaii. If you would like to sponsor the channel for as low as $2 to $5 per month and guarantee that this channel keeps going, click the link in the description below and sign up. And until next time, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80s slasher librarian saying, thanks for listening, happy Friday the 13th, and I'll see you next time.